This is Bob Ambrogi, and today we are getting a briefing from Briefpoint about their new product called Autodoc that automates discovery drafting. Here to show it to us is the CEO of Briefpoint, Nathan Walter. Nathan, always good to see you.
Great to see you as well, Bob. I am very excited to show you Autodoc today.
So before we dive into the demo, which we'll do quickly, but why don't you kind of give us the background a little bit on what this is and what you're going to be showing us.
Absolutely. So Briefpoint is a solution that drafts discovery responses and discovery requests. So it's an out-of-the-box solution, and we started Briefpoint to eliminate discovery work. What we're showing you today is a step towards eDiscovery in that we're going to be uploading a production of documents. So my case is reports, emails, all the files that you would normally produce in a case. And then we're going to upload my opposing counsel's request for production. And what we're going to get out of this is, number one, a baited production package. And number two, a Word document that's an RFP response that's captioned with every request, all the objections handled. And critically, we're going to automate the substantive responses to every RFP at the rate of about 2 to 10 seconds per request. So this is a really exciting update just in legal tech in general. And I'm really excited to show you.
It is really exciting. And you kind of say a step towards e-discovery. Explain what you mean by that.
Yeah. So we don't think this is going to be a replacement for full-fledged e-discovery, which is generally isolated or reserved for those huge cases with large productions and large values. This is for the 10,000 document or less cases, maybe 20,000. We haven't tested it with millions of documents. We don't recommend it. This is for the 99% of cases that aren't big enough or don't have enough documents to warrant the e-discovery expenditure. And because we're a thousandth of the cost of e-discovery, it makes sense to use this product as a supplement for e-discovery when the case wouldn't warrant it anyways.
Critically, it is pulling out the documents that you might otherwise have had to manually go through and pull out, much like the discovery process.
Exactly. And we sort of skip the relevancy check because we're looking for responsiveness. So we just look at the opposing counsel's every request for production, and we find all the documents that are responsive to that request. And so we don't need to determine whether or not the document is relevant or not. Of course, if it's asking for irrelevant documents, you can just not answer. But we find the documents that are responsive. And that is a much more useful conclusion than determining that these documents are relevant, because even if documents are relevant, if your opposing counsel doesn't ask for them, they're not going to be produced.
Well, I guess it tells you something about me, because I'm really excited to see this. So why don't we just dive in and
dive in? So this is Briefpoint, and this is the sort of landing page you go to. Now, I've already uploaded my case file. Uploading the case file it's an hours process. So it's a really long process because we do a bunch of pre-processing. So you upload all the files, and then we shoot you an email when it's ready. And here, the documents are ready. So I'm going to upload my opposing counsel's request for production. And we're going to do this in California, but this works in all jurisdictions. So all 50 states, DC, and all 98 district courts. And here's my opposing counsel's request for production. Once it's done processing, we're going to click Get Started. And I'm going to confirm some information we pulled out of the document. We use this to create a case folder and also populate the caption page. We have information on the parties, et cetera. And now what we're looking at is a workflow where we've extracted all 5 of the requests for productions from my opposing counsel's PDF, and we're allowing our user to respond. Now, the actual RFP in this case had 50 RFPs. I've shortened it down to 5 for the purpose of this demo. And what we can do, what Briefpoint normally does, is you can click on your objections to lodge the objections from the objection menu. But what's new here is this Find Documents button. And when I click Find Documents, Briefpoint is going to take this RFP, it's going to take the definitions of the terms in that RFP and a summary of the case, and go through the entire production and collect all of the documents that are responsive to this request. And in this instance, we found 122 documents. Now, this is AI, and at Briefpoint, we say, don't trust AI, verify. And so we want our users to click verify, where, of course, we'll show you the documents that we're actually going to produce, so you can review the PDFs and wait for these 122 documents to load. But there's another feature that I want to draw your attention to, which is the view all or verify all. And what we're looking at here is a foldering structure that Briefpoint created to organize all the documents you uploaded. Now, this
was part of that processing when you uploaded the documents.
That's like why it takes so long. We're creating a document management system based on your upload. And if you have one PDF with three documents, we'll break that PDF into three distinct documents and title them and do everything and organize them into this document management system. You can use this document management system for your own organizational purposes, but the primary reason we did this was to show you where our system looked, which is represented by the dark green folders, and where we didn't look in the white folders. So you can review the request for production and say, wait a second, this seems like that might be producible. In this case, it's not responsive, but if it was, you can just check it, and then add it to make sure you're not leaving anything on the table. And we can refine your requisite document review to all of the documents to just the places or the documents organized that are most likely to be relevant. And when this is formally launched in a few weeks, this will also highlight folders that are most likely to contain documents that are relevant that we didn't produce. And another thing that this can do.
Just to stop on that just for a second.
Yes.
Before you showed highlight, the folders were highlighted that you extracted the documents from. But this will be a second step of having some different form of highlighting on the folders.
Yellow highlight.
Yeah. Okay.
We metaphorically highlight the ones we didn't look at because we have a white folder. And if I go into this verification step, we can go here. And then this sort of slash means we look through some, but not all the folders. And then we're going to highlight folders and surface folders that are most likely to contain relevant documents that you should always review before clicking add to response.
Yeah.
And it will literally be a yellow highlight there. In eDiscovery, when you're processing things using AI and eDiscovery, they use technology-assisted review or TAR, and they can give you a confidence interval where they say, hey, these 7,000 documents are 10% relevant, right? They can't do what we call needle and haystack, where it finds only the documents that are responsive to a request. Frankly, they only check for relevance anyways, but they can't find a single or double documents here. Briefpoint, because of the way the system works and with the benefit of dealing with less than massive productions, we can actually find needle and haystacks. Like in this case, we found two documents, and those are only the two documents that are responsive to the school. And by the way, if you click suggest, Briefpoint will automatically object for you and will write the objections too. So I'm going to include those in. Another thing eDiscovery can't do is tell you that there are no documents in the production. If you're dealing with a case where you have a ton of documents and it asks, hey, give me this one document or give me these documents and you don't have it in the production, the only way to find that you don't have a document is by going reading all of the production. And the same is true for needle and haystack. Here, there are no documents, so you can click unable to produce, and we have different grounds that you're unable to produce this document, or you can click send to client. We'll convert this RFP into plain English and collect the response from your client, so you're good there. And then here, this is another needle and haystack where there's only, I think, a couple of documents here, or maybe only one, and I'm just lodging objections over here. I was the defense counsel, so I have a bad habit of just blindly objecting to everything.
And finally, you just revealed the truth about defense counsel.
Maybe I was just a bad one. I don't know. The final test I want to show you is this, where we say, give me all documents that support your first cause of action for negligence. So this is like more on the legal analysis side. But in this situation, because we know the facts of the case, we know the type of negligence that's being asked for, in this case, it's premise liability, we can actually find documents that are responsive to these more legal theory-esque types of questions. Okay, so we just finished these five. They're all ready to go. Click review, and then you set up how you want your Bates numbers to start or look, and you can have a preview there because, again, we're getting a baited production package. Click save and continue. And as a final safety precaution, we show you all the documents that you've uploaded for this case that we didn't add into any response. And this is just to ensure you're not leaving anything on the table. And it allows you to do a final check. And in this case, because I shortened the RFP for the demo, there's a lot. And what you can do is just check these off. You can, of course, view them and then add them in to the documents that they are responsive or the requests that they're responsive to. And those will get sorted in. So this is like a final checklist, just a safety precaution. You click download production. You get a zip folder with all the PDFs baited, and the titles of the PDFs are baited, and we have a title of each document that you can serve on opposing counsel and response. And then we have this. This is a Word document that we just generated. The caption page is already completed because we automatically do that. And it's for California because the document we uploaded was California. Whenever you upload a document, we identify the jurisdiction, and the Word documents you generate in that case are always going to be formatted automatically to your jurisdiction's formatting rules and customs. We have a preliminary statement, general objections, and then we have a completed RFP response doc with the objections and, critically, the response, where we're citing to all the responsive documents by their baits. There's no more accurate way to identify responsive documents than by their page and their baits, and that's exactly what we've done. And just looking at this, where this is the question asking about documents that support a first cause of action for negligence, these documents are all over the production. This response probably would have taken you or your staff a half an hour, and we can do this in a few seconds. And all of it can be verified, and we have a proof of service as well. This is ready to go. Save your signature, and you're good.
And then you've got the actual documents being produced are in, you've created a separate PDF download that
yeah,
has the
click
base
download production. You get a zip file, which is just a folder full of all the PDFs that are responsive. They're all baited, and the title of each PDF is split into separate documents where we have the baits range in the title as well as the title of the document. So you can quickly review that, and it's helpful for, you know, just producing that to opposing counsel.
Yeah, that is really cool, and I was right to be excited to see it. Never seen anything like that, for sure. Just a couple steps back, when you were, and the request was, you know, all documents supporting the first cause of action or something like that. We're kind of asking more for to support a legal argument rather than a factual analysis. How does it know that? Had you already uploaded the complaint or other pleadings in the case that?
Exactly. Yeah. So if I can show you a sample case where we don't have a production uploaded, let's see here. Yes. So when you upload your production, you're brought here. And so you have to upload the complaint and then the documents.
Okay.
And the reason we do that is so that we can, you know, answer those things, but also so that we, when we create the document management system with all the folders, we do so with as close to the same information framework as the attorney would if they were going to create the foldering structure. Because we want the foldering structure to be as familiar as possible. So when you're using it for document management, so if I go into here, you can understand the nature of these folders and use this to organize documents. You can also flag documents as privileged, which adds them to a privilege list. And this has practical benefits, but again, the primary use of this is just to show you our work. It has the collateral benefit of creating an autonomously generated document management system for every case.
Yeah. So does it matter? Is this any better or worse if you're a plaintiff or a defendant, or does that not?
No, it's we serve both sides of the field. It's about an even split in our customer base. You, obviously, the complaint is plaintiff favorable, but we extract an objective framing of the case where we just go over the causes of action, the parties, what this is about, a loose timeline of the events, and that allows us to have an objective sort of overview of the case. And if you want, you can also include a cross complaint into that PDF to get a more full picture. But we really just need to know, okay, what kind of case is this? Who are the parties involved? Because we need to know who's asking who the questions, the timeline of the events, and the nature of the case.
I already know the answer to this, but for anybody watching who may not know the answer, what jurisdictions do you cover?
All 50 U.S. states, D.C., and all 98 federal district courts.
Again, just for people who are watching this who may not be familiar, I mean, this is a exciting new feature, new capability that you have, but this isn't all you do. I mean, I wonder if you could just kind of talk more generally about the context of this.
Yeah. So Briefpoint, you know, we draft propounding or outgoing sets of discovery and discovery responses. So the propounding discovery is done where you upload a complaint, whether or not you're plaintiff or defendant. We break down the complaint and then we recreate it as a set of tailored interrogatories, requests for productions, and requests for admissions. We do so very quickly. And then we also allow our users to pull template questions or standard questions from our library of over 6,000 discovery requests that are just part of every account to make sure that you have your standard questions in every case and your tailored ones, and you can build your own library as well. For discovery responses, we do responses to all types of discovery, and we have a robust client collection or client response collection feature, which will allow you to send interrogatories to a client. And when we do that, We convert all the interrogatories into plain English so a non-attorney client can actually understand what's being asked, which was designed to replicate the phone call I would have with my clients, where I would just have a narrative conversation or normal conversation with them about what information I need to answer this discovery. They would respond to me, I would take notes and then convert it into the response. We've replicated that using AI to convert the interrogatories into conversational English and also conversational Spanish if you want to translate, and then add in their responses. So the overarching goal of Briefpoint is to completely eliminate discovery work from litigation. What we're seeing here with the RFP response, the Autodoc, is a massive step towards that. The second version of this will do the same for interrogatories, and then we're going to be doing a motion to compels, or we're analyzing opposing counsel's responses. We're going to be giving you a tool to find the answers to any questions you have within the production. All of this is built on the framework of the Autodoc feature and everything else we have in Briefpoint in order to give you access to the facts of the case and eliminate discovery work.
Nathan, you and I spoke earlier this week about this before I got a chance to actually see it. But one question I had then is about privileged documents. How do you handle privileged documents here?
That's a really good question. So we don't handle, well, we don't have an automated way to check for privilege. The goal is that you've checked for privilege already and uploaded them into Briefpoint, and we don't redact either yet, at least not in the first version. However, in a subsequent version, which will be out this year, you'll be able to, in the document, if I share my screen here, you'll be able to search for things like the name of an attorney, like John. And we'll show you all the documents that not only have John or the attorney's name in the title, but also that relate or have content that relates to the attorneys. And then you can designate them as privileged before producing your answer. Well, we'll take it out of the production. We'll give you a privilege documents that are listed. And then for redactions later, probably in 26, you'll be able to say redact all references to X. And then we'll go through all the production, show you where all those references are, and then allow you to redact those in Briefpoint as well.
All right. Will that include like personal identifying information of any?
Yeah, you would say redact all personal identifying information for John Doe, and then the system will find all of that information, show it to you, and then you'll just approve the redaction of all of that. That'll be next year.
Yeah, that's really great. If I am already a customer of Briefpoint, how much more is it going to cost me to get this?
Oh yeah, this is added to everyone's account at no additional cost. Yeah, so this is just, if you're already a user of Briefpoint, it's added to your account at no additional cost, and the cost to subscribe will include this. And the way it's going to be included is you're going to get page processing credits per month that roll over. By default, 2,000 pages per month per attorney account. You can upgrade your account. You can buy one-off doc page packs if you need to have a larger production. We are operating on razor-thin margins here with the AI processing costs. The goal for the business perspective is sort of to be like Costco, where we just reduce the cost of everything, and then just the subscription is what we make our money on, and then we just try to give you these AI processing features at as close to cost as we can.
What else would you like people to know about this?
You can, if you see this and you want to test it out, starting September 23rd, we're going to be taking people off the waitlist. So if you go to briefpoint.ai and you go to Autodoc, join the waitlist. And if you mention in other or something that you saw this, we will, saw this podcast or this video, we will put you at the top of the waitlist, or we'll accelerate you ahead of the waitlist.
I like that. Good. All right. Well, this is really cool. It's a great feature. And I mean, I would think that this could be a hugely valuable time saver for litigators in any number of matters. So congratulations on this.
Thank you so much, Bob. I'm really excited to hear what people think about this. And I'm just lucky to be in a position to be able to build this kind of stuff.
Yeah, sure. It's fun. Better than being a litigator, right? No, I won't put you on the spot.
Pros and cons.
Yeah, okay. All right. Well, Nathan, thanks so much. Good to talk to you. Appreciate it.
You as well, Bob.